makes sense, and I find great consolation, great happiness in that level of understanding. Just ponder for a moment Darwin's central idea, the tree of all life, now verified as fact by our decoded DNA. It means we are related to every living thing on the planet. And what's more, we are descended from ancestors who were winners, adapting in any way possible to survive and pass on their genes.
You and I and every living creature can make the following proud claim. Not a single one of my ancestors died young. Not a single one of my ancestors failed to copulate. Plenty of other individuals died young and failed to copulate, but they didn't become ancestors. It's blindingly obvious, but from it, much follows. It means that every single living creature has inherited the genes of an unbroken line of successful ancestors. We have all of us inherited what it takes to survive and reproduce. That's why we're so good at what we do, why fish are so good at swimming, why birds are so good at flying, why aardvarks are so good at digging, why humans are so good at thinking. That, in essence, is Darwinism.
Darwin had to bury two more of his children in his lifetime. Another daughter and a son died in early infancy.
In memory of Mary Eleanor and Charles Waring, children of Charles Darwin.
Darwin confronted grief in his own way. He found solace, I think, in the very earth in which he had to bury his children. For his last book, he turned to earthworms. Darwin was fascinated by how, little by little, over huge lengths of time, their slow turning of the soil churned the whole surface of the earth. Nature's ploughs had their own extraordinary underground economy, a damp, dark, life and death struggle, to which we humans were totally oblivious. I doubt, Darwin wrote, whether there are many other animals which have played so important a part in the history of the world. So Darwin didn't wallow in man-made notions of the supernatural or an afterlife. His down-to-earth wonder at nature was his cure for loss of faith. I'm going to visit someone with a similar outlook, the philosopher Dan Dennett. I've known him for 25 years. We're the same age, but I think of him as a kind of intellectual elder brother. But recently, he had a brush with mortality.
There was a terrible crisis with his heart, and his friends were all told that he was going to die. It was a very scary moment. Afterwards, when he was recovering in hospital, he made the point that many of his friends had said that they prayed for him, and he thanked them, but then added, "And did you also sacrifice a goat?"
Dan has no shred of faith in God or eternity. Does he think his Darwinism would deny people comfort?
I think it only undermines a crutch that they don't need, and that's the crutch of an absolute immortal soul. That's an idea that a lot of people think is very important. And what it does, of course, is it replaces it with the idea of a material mortal soul. Yeah, we have souls, but they're made of neurons. And the little neurons individually are just blind little biorobots. They don't know, they don't care, they're just doing their jobs. The amazing thing is that if you put enough of them together in the right sort of teams, you have basically a soul. You have the control system and the memory of a being that can be held responsible, that can hold himself or herself responsible, that can look into the future.
And when people say, well, where do you get your consolation from? I sort of feel, well, how much more do you want? What?
Indeed. What could be more wonderful than being part of this amazing living tapestry of growth and exploration and innovation, all happening in not a million, not a billion, but in a trillion places at once. The just to look just at our planet, the exuberance of the life processes going on around us and all of the creativity that is there is just stunning. It's great to wake up in the morning and realize that you're a part of this.
And not only are we a part of it, but we can reflect on the fact that our ability to realize that, our ability to understand it and to exult in it, is itself the product of the same process. Our brains so capable of appreciating this have been produced by the very same process that we are now appreciating.
Yeah. Sometimes I like to say the planet has grown a nervous system, and it's us.
Charles Darwin died in 1882. "I'm not in the least afraid to die," he whispered to his wife Emma in his last days. Darwin had wanted to be buried in Down, next to his two dead children. In the event, however, the scientific establishment insisted on the accolade of burial in Westminster Abbey. A host of scientists, philosophers, and celebrities attended on the day. In true C of E style, the church attempted to absorb the man who had brought down the house. Yet, even so, the Archbishop of Canterbury turned out to be indisposed, and the God-fearing Prime Minister, William Gladstone, pleaded prior engagements. Perhaps not for them, the funeral of the scientist whose work, more than any other, has proved the biblical creation story shallow and wanting. I revere Charles Darwin. He made sense of life. The world is amazing, even more amazing than Darwin knew. And the more we discover, the more petty our little private beliefs seem. Does Darwinism leave a gaping hole where religion once was? No, rather it opens our minds to a world of majesty, the real magic all around us. Not based on uncertain faith, but sound science. In this handful of soil, there are about 25 billion bacteria. That's four times the entire human population of the planet. We humans and the animals we can actually see are a tiny fraction of life on Earth. In the perspective of the universe, the vastness of the universe and of geological time, we are insignificant. Some people find that thought disturbing, even frightening. Like Darwin, I find the reality thrilling.